Hello, and welcome to the third installment of Emmanuel Lutheran's Lenten video series on the covenant of baptism. In this video, we will discuss the theme of how we hear the Word of God, how we share in the Lord's Supper. I am Dana Yost. I'm a member of the congregation here at Emmanuel.
And I'm Cindi Lehman.
We'll start with reading the two Bible verses that go with this video.
I'm going to read from Psalm 119, verse 97 through 104. Oh, how I love your law. I meditate it on it all day long. Your commands make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more insight than all my teachers, for I meditate on your statutes. I have more understanding than the elders, for I obey your precepts. I have kept my feet from the evil path, so that I might obey your word. I have not departed from your laws, for you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts. Therefore, I hate every wrong path. And from Luke chapter 24, 28 through 32. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us, while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?"
Thanks, Cindi. You know, the last week and a half or so since we started to prepare for this, and as I've read those verses, it's going to sound a little crazy, but sometimes as I'm reading about the Word of God, I think about this cat that we had when we lived in Minnesota. She was a cat that craved attention and was always very affectionate. When I would watch TV in our living room, I'd sit in the recliner, and she'd climb up on my chest and would just sit there while I'm watching TV. And mm-hmm. she liked to be around us. And we had a three-season porch at our house, and a lot of times I like to go out there to the love seat in the afternoon and take an afternoon nap. And usually I thought I was closing the door to the porch, but the cat would always find a way out there. And I'd be asleep, and all, you know, when it's time to wake up, or as I'm waking up, I look, my eyes start to open, and there is the cat right there in front of me. She's like, oh yeah, she's just
purring away.
She's purring, and she's eyeball to eyeball, you know, just that far away from my face, you know. And she's probably been watching me the whole time I've been asleep. You know, I mean, and all I had to do was open my eyes to see her, and in a way that there's a parallel there to what we read, you know, what Cindi read in the Luke passages into our relationship with God all the time. He's always right there, eyeball to eyeball with us, always walking with us, always watching us. He wants our attention. He wants us to be in touch with him. And all we have to do really is just open our eyes, and he's right there. You know, and we're going to get a lot better reward, a lot better conversation than a meowing cat. We're going to get time with God, you know, and mm-hmm. like the two men on the road to Emmaus, they didn't know what they were missing, you know, this is Jesus walking with them, telling them the entire history of the Bible and where he fits into that, and all he had to do was open their eyes and they got it, you know, and he was gone, but they still heard it then, you know, so. Mm-hmm. So these two verses to me, these two passages to me talk about our relationship with God and how important it is to be aware of his presence in our lives and how important it is to make time to be, you know, to be in communion with God, to whether, you know, listening to, you know, and I think, you know, the opening our eyes is a metaphor maybe too, is, you know, that I use, but how, you know, we can open our ears so we can listen to God, open our hearts so he can be alive in our souls with us, you know. So so, and one of the things we want to talk about then is the point of the theme of this is listening to the Word of God. So, Cindi, what do you think are some ways we can do that?
Well, I always love song, and my family will tell you I go around singing a song. And when you were talking, I think of the song, "Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord."
Yeah.
You know, and even just singing that prayer over and over, you know, or calling for God. We've talked about that before. Is calling upon the name of Jesus, or saying, "Be away from me, Satan," or
yep,
"Jesus, help me." You know, those are ways that I personally have warded off Satan. Say, "Away from me, Satan," yeah, just like yeah, Christ did. But, you know, open the eyes of my heart, praying that over and over, and God listens. And, you know, I have great examples. I was thinking, just as you were talking about that, two ways we see God. Yesterday was the 21st anniversary of my mother's death. And I was there the day that she died, and I can remember it perfectly. And I know I met Christ face to face that day. For in the hospice room, my mother was there, and then I left to go get a soda. And I remember meeting, it happened to be in a nursing home, this gentleman who I thought maybe he had dementia or something. But I remember specifically him saying 4 o'clock, and I'm like, what's going to happen at 4 o'clock? Yes, I bet they're going to feed you at that time. And, you know, I was pretty preoccupied saying, woe is me, you know, whatever. But I specifically remember him saying that. Later on that afternoon, I was in the hospice room with my mother, and she died at 4 o'clock.
Oh, my gosh. Ugh.
You know, and I remember my dad saying, Marjorie, whatever. And I'm like, and I happened to look up and saw there was at 4 o'clock. So I think that, I know that God is with us, and I know he's there present. Maybe it's in a person in the nursing home. Mm. Maybe it's in the sunset, or maybe it's in Dana meeting me someplace and saying, hey, remember, Cindi, you need to do something. Yeah. You know, God's with us, but it can't just be a one-way relationship, us always telling God our wants and needs. We need to have that quiet time to listen to him. The best way I find is taking time during devotion time, or even, you know, picking up my Bible if I don't have a set devotion plan, even to just reading through a few passages, and maybe he'll recall somebody's name to me that I need to minister to or pray for, or give me even answers to my prayers that maybe are long forgotten. So those are some of the ways I've used prayer and quiet time, but it's pretty hard to stop our busy world from rolling on along, because we don't take time necessarily to see the many wonders God has given.
No, yeah, we don't. And that's part of, I think, what maybe we can hope, we hope that we can maybe help everybody kind of see, is that there are ways within our busy days and to take some time, and that it is very important to do that. You know, 'cause as much as we might lift our voices to God, he's doing the same to us. He is talking to us all the time. And the Psalm 119 talks about the wonder that can come if we listen to God, if we meditate, if we find that quietness, and we start to hear what God is saying, or feel it, or see it. Mm-hmm. You know, how sweet are your words to my taste, sweet like honey to my mouth. I mean, that's saying that God is, if we listen to God, it's an enjoyable, meaningful experience. And, you know, so it is important, I think, that we find a way every day to take some time, 10 minutes, 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. I'd like to do actual meditation where I'll sit and deliberately be quiet and then pray, but then take time after I'm done with my prayers to just see what God might say, or see what, like mm-hmm. you said, see what names come up, or what thoughts or ideas come up. But it's just, you know, just to let, give him room to talk, you mm-hmm. know. But I know that we can't all stop our lives for 15 minutes. So, you know, there right. are other ways. I mean, obviously, and there's some literal ways. You know, if you read the Bible, that's the Word of God. He's talking to us. If you go right. to worship, we're going to hear the Word of God read to us, sung to us. But in our daily lives, there are ways that maybe we can buy some time, find a little extra time that we don't see, that we can we can be with God. You know,
well, some of it for me probably is turning off Facebook or turning off technology. I'm off on Fridays, and for a while I like to have the television on to catch up on the morning news or whatever. But I have to intentionally go turn off the television, turn off the noise that's around me, you know, and take a few minutes. And it's not even long stretches of time sometimes that I can get. It's those brief minutes that I could get to listen in that way. So those are some of the other.
Oh, yeah. You know, we've talked to some other members about what they might do. You know, we've heard, you know, when you're doing dishes, when you're doing laundry, when you're driving to work, you know, mm-hmm. you know, turn off talk radio, which isn't a bad idea anyway. But, you know, but use that time to listen to
right.
and talk to God. You know, some of these just routine daily tasks that we can do mindlessly, almost take that time then to be with God.
You know, we talk about spiritual disciplines. I exercise on a regular basis Monday morning through Friday morning at 5:30 in the morning. That's a discipline I do because I know it's not going to get easier as I get older. In addition, one of my regular disciplines is Sunday morning. And so coming to worship and hearing God, I might not always feel like Sunday morning at 8 o'clock when I do get up or whatever, that's where the first place I want to be. But just like going to the Y or exercising, I'm always glad when I've gotten there.
Yeah.
I'm never sorry. I wish I would have spent that hour someplace else. And even if it's not for me, it's for the community. And I think we talked about that last week a little bit, about living in community. You know,
yeah.
I had recently a member of our church, this sweet lady, sitting in front of me, and she turned around and said, "I'm so glad you came today because I needed to hear your voice." And I thought,
yeah.
Oh, that's a whole new perspective for me because I come so that I can be fed, but sometimes coming means that living in community so that others can be fed too.
Absolutely, yeah, and it's another way that we can hear God. It's not; those are more regular routine than what you experience with your mom.
Yeah.
But through like where I sit in church, it's usually the same 6 to 10 people sitting behind, in front, and around me, and I'm the same thing. I'm used to their voices being there, whether singing or reading, you know, or saying the liturgy. And you do get fed that way, and you do hear God talking to you through these familiar voices. So it is huge.
What's the second part of our spiritual discipline we talked about?
It is how we can share in the Lord's Supper. And Cindi, you have some really, really good thoughts about what communion means to you.
You know, I love our liturgical church, I'll tell you that much, first of all, because there's so many things that have such deep spiritual meaning to me. After we've shared the peace, coming up for communion, and I've scripturally, hopefully literally, given, you know, forgiven those around me. But remembering my baptism when I come, I don't know if you recognize, but in this sanctuary, the baptismal font is right in front of where we receive communion. And so I come forward and dip my fingers and make the sign of the cross on my forehead. Remembering my baptism. Remembering these baptismal promises
that
I've made for myself, you know, at confirmation. I've made for my children at their baptism. Someone's made for me at my baptism. So they're very right there for us. But remembering that baptism, and then as I receive that forgiveness from Christ, I'm not only receiving and communing with you next to me, Dana, like this, but the whole communion of believers, including my mother that we talked about earlier, and and those that'll come after us, my grandkids, my great-grandkids, whatever it may be. So that's, for me, receiving that body and blood of Christ in that way is very, very spiritual to me. And I just enjoy that part of it, the quiet, again, being quiet, stilling my heart and my thoughts to focus on Christ.
Yeah, I think there's a parallel between the communion part and prayer part, where these are some times where we are very, very close, where we can be very, very close to Christ, to feeling his presence in our minds and our souls. You know, I know people will stop at each station during communion, you know, when they get the bread, when they get the wine, they might say a short prayer, or they might just, you know, take a breath or two, so to make each part of that meaningful before they sit down, you know. And
I think sometimes they call those thin places.
Yes, yeah.
Where we meet God very close, face to face.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, this liminal moment, you know, there's another word for thin places where we and God, you know, yeah, we are really, you know, within just a membrane of space between him and us, mm-hmm. you know, and it's a very sacred moment. And so there's a lot to be gained. But, you know, and also there's out of communion, as we come out of that with a cleansed spirit and a cleansed heart, and that helps us maybe in our dealings with other people after
right.
that, you know. And like you have talked about that a little bit, about being right with God before we can be right with others, you know. And,
yeah, so. When you list your priorities of what you have, God, family, you know, self, if God's not at the top of the list, how can I be right with you, Dana? How can I be right with my husband? You know, I have to be right with God. And communion gives me an opportunity to make right with God, that I've received his forgiveness as a child of God. I can go forth from there, and I can share and tell other people that they are a child of God, that they are forgiven. I can extend God's grace to them.
Grace is a very important word to us as Lutherans. You know, it's something we use, we believe in. It's something that we probably need to do more to act out and employ when we are with others. But there's a really nice devotion in the Christ in Our Home devotional book from January 25th, which talks about that, about all of these topics, about being quiet, listening to God. And it says that when we focus on really listening to what God is saying, we can discover a whole new life and find grace that we haven't realized was there before. You know, so again, it all reinforces that these moments with God are so important in our lives, that we want to make the time to have those moments, because it opens a new way of living and of dealing with other people, of interacting, and it makes us probably healthier spiritually.
So, yeah. I've told a friend of mine recently too that faith isn't easy. It takes time mm-hmm. and building a relationship. I'm sure many of our people that are watching today, their spouses or boyfriends, girlfriends, parents, they didn't automatically get a good relationship with God. It took time. It took time sitting in the presence. It took time eating meals, you know. And so having time with Christ builds and strengthens that relationship. I mean, he's always there, like your cat is there.
Yeah,
unless you open your eyes to see him, you don't know that cat's there.
Yeah.
You don't know that God is there listening, waiting for you. I mean, that's, yes. And God's grace is a gift. Nothing I've done, you know, can ever earn me communion with him, can ever earn me fellowship with him. So remembering that helps me to give grace more freely too, because there's nothing I've done to be here today. There's nothing I've done to be fortunate enough to live in Forest City, you know, and have the many blessings that have been bestowed on us. But through God's grace and through his free gift of eternal life.
You know, as you reflect on this message, maybe ask yourself, what noisy distractions can you reduce or eliminate so that you can hear God's word more and spend more time with him?
I have a friend who lives down in Pella, and she said she had coffee with God every morning. That was her way to open her Bible and have a cup of coffee with the Lord every morning. She had a special prayer chair that she sat in, her favorite chair. So I would challenge you to find a place that is comfortable to you, that's without distractions, that you can come face to face with the Lord.
Yeah. I think those are the two big things, finding a place and a time.
So,
Well, we'll end with a prayer.
Sounds good.
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for watching us today, and thanks for watching this video series. We hope it's been meaningful to you. Gracious and generous God, thank you for listening to us and for speaking to us. Help us be better listeners to you, making time each day to be more open to your presence around us, more open to your word. Thank you, too, for the spiritual replenishment and the wonderful reminder of the cross we gain through communion, through that gift of grace. Thank you. And help us see opportunities as well where we can share our faith and fellowship with one another. Amen.